And it sits right at the center of the Stonehenge monument. It's the bit that you stand on to watch the sunrise between the other stones over there. So it's right at the middle. So it must have been placed there as an important stone. It's very different, so it must have had it stood out like a sore thumb compared to everything else. And to bring it 700 kilometers, however you brought it, whether you brought it down by boat or whether you brought it over land, yeah, but it must have taken a huge effort to do that. The altar stone is quite different in size from the majority of the other blue stones. 5 meters long, 15, 16 feet long, 1 meter wide, 1/2 meter deep. It lies flat to the ground at the top, partly covered by two other fallen stones, so you can't see it. Bless it, unfortunately. It's possibly one of the least inspirational stones at Stonehenge and has one of the most sort of enigmatic and evocative names, the altar stone.
Done the smaller piece.
So, and they're all labelled 85 by Mr. Cunnington. He just picked up a load of
book from the Cursus, which is near Stonehenge, is a sandstone, as the altar stone is, but it's not altar stone.
Different chemistry.
Different chemistry, different mineralogy. So what we need to do is be certain that the fragments we've got are altar stone.
It's a microanalysis technique. You fire a very focused laser beam on the minerals in the rock, and it vaporizes them. You analyze the vapor, and you analyze the uranium concentrations and the lead concentrations. And by looking at the ratios of those, essentially, you can work out the age of the mineral. And that age of the mineral, then you analyze another one, you analyze another one, and you analyze 50 or 60 minerals. And you get this fingerprint of the different ages of those minerals in the rock. And that's the characteristic that tells us this is Orcadian basin. It's that age, that suite of ages from those individual minerals in the grains in the altar stone. And the match for this sort of age fingerprint that you get from these minerals is identical to the Orcadian basin in Scotland, not Wales. We sort of thought it can't be Wales, we need to look further afield. So suddenly it's gone from being 250 kilometres from Stonehenge, give or take, to 700 kilometres from Stonehenge. It's just one of those monuments that intrigues everybody, I think, partly because nobody really knows what it's for, partly because it has all this fascinating astronomical alignment and so on, partly because it's in an area that was enormously populated and enormously active in terms of archaeological features for several thousand years before Stonehenge was built. So it was in a landscape that was clearly inhabited and used and so on. Yeah, quite exactly what or why or how, I think, still remain to be discovered. But the geology, I think the geology has been interesting because it's now with non-destructive techniques that you can start to do things with the stones that are there. And that's helped us a lot, being able to just use sort of portable methods to start answering chemical questions or mineralogical questions. And I think there'll be other things to come from it. We'll figure out more as we keep looking.